العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. قال تبارك وتعالى وأذن في الناس بالحج يأتوك رجالا وعلى كل ضامر يأتين من كل فج عميق. وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما علمت أن الإسلام يهدم ما كان قبله وأن الهجرة تهدم ما كان قبلها وأن الحج يهدم ما كان قبله أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters, and youngsters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we send salutations upon the final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. Every imperative and every injunction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is about goodness and mercy, and it's to further this blessing of virtue and mercy. Whether it be the command of prayer or whether it be the command of fasting. And we know that this is the season of Hajj. Dhul Qa'dah is coming to a conclusion, and the month of Dhul Hijjah will be entering insha'Allah, and people from all over the world will be assembling at the Baytullah to perform the Hajj. And we supplicate, we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless one and all with the opportunity to visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all of these injunctions, all of these pillars, all of these imperatives, they're to further the cause of goodness and mercy and to increase these blessings. In a narration that is found in Bazaar on the strength of Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he makes a mention that at one occasion the Prophet peace and blessings upon him caught our attention. And he said, Al-Islamu Ashum. He said, the religion of Islam is full of elements and parts. And then he began listing. He said, Al-Islamu Sahmun. Islam itself is an imperative part of our lives. As-Salatu Sahmun. The prayer is a very important element and part of our lives. Az-Zakatu Sahmun. Al-Amru Wan-Nahyu Sahmun. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, continued to list many good deeds, and he said, these are all part and parcel of our lives. These are all part and parcel of our deen and our religion. And then he also mentioned Wal-Hajju, to visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to perform the pilgrimage, is also a very important element and part of our lives. And as believers, this is an important pillar of Islam as we know. And towards the conclusion of this narration that I'm giving reference to, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ لَا سَهْمَ لَهُ. Indeed, that person is unsuccessful, is a loser, who has no portion from these portions, who has no elements, who has no particular attachment with any one of these parts of our lives that are very important to us through the deen of Islam. So indeed, Hajj is definitely a very important element of Islam. At one occasion, Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, he was on his deathbed, and the people, hadarna, it's mentioned by the tabi'un that we surrounded Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, and we surrounded him. He was in his last few moments, and when we entered his place, we heard crying, فَبَكَى طَوِيلًا, and he continued to cry. He was weeping. So when the people felt uncomfortable, the son got up and he said to his father, oh my dear father, you are amongst the ashab. You are amongst the companions of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. أَمَا بَشَرْتَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ هَكَذَا وَهَكَذَا. Didn't the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, give you glad tidings that you are of such and such a status, and you will be blessed with such and such a success? And he continued to list all the positives. So Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, he turned around to his son and the congregation, the audience that had gathered on his last few moments. And he said, definitely the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, gave me these glad tidings. But I'm looking at my situation from three angles. Number one is before Islam, where I was misguided. I probably committed every sin of the book. But then Allah brought Islam to me. And then he related his incident of how he accepted Islam. And this is what I wanted to mention here. So Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu said that when Allah gave me guidance of Islam, I immediately went to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I came in his presence and I said, I wish to accept Islam. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, asked him, Ubsut yadak. He said, stretch your hand, give me your hand. I want to facilitate the pledge of allegiance for you, the bay'ah for you. So he was about to take his hand out when the Prophet ﷺ took his hand and he withdrew. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, asked him, Malaka ya Amr? He said, what's wrong, O Amr? Did you change your intention? What's the situation? So he said, no, I just want to put down some conditions. Ashtarit. Aradtu an ashtarit. I wish to put down some conditions. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, asked him, what are those conditions you would like to put down? So he said, I wish that I could be forgiven of all my past. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, then addressed him and said, Ama alimta ya Amr, do you not know, O Amr, anna al-Islam yahdimu ma kana qabla? That once you accept Islam, everything that you have done in the past is forgiven. And do you not know, anna al-hijrata tahdimu ma kana qabla? Migration is also such a profound action that it deletes, it removes all the sin of the past. And then he made mention of the Hajj, the pilgrimage, and he said, وَأَنَّ الْحَجَّ يَهْدِمُ مَا كَانَ قَبْلَهُ. Pilgrimage is also a means for removing one's sin and the past that one has committed. So it's a new beginning, O Amr. You've accepted Islam, it's a new beginning. Now the reason for his cry, he makes a mention. So he says, this is my condition, three angles. One angle is before Islam, and he was seeking forgiveness for that. Number two is while in Islam with the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. And the third angle that he was comprehending and that caused him to weep, he said, وُلِّينَا بَعْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ. We were granted position and authority. We had desire for wealth and the blessings increased. We became the governors. We became the leaders. And I fear so much that after the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, passed away, and we were assigned these tasks, if we did not fulfill them to the trust that was given to us, then we will be questioned on the Day of Judgment for that. And that is what is causing me to cry. And that is what is causing me to weep. So I seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's mentioned in the report that everyone that was present, they also joined Amr ibn al-As in weeping. So these were profound people. They did the job to the best of their ability, yet they feared. Yet they had this fear in their heart that how can I be answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and accountable to Him. So in this narration that we gave reference to, Hajj was also mentioned. Now, we know this is the occasion when people are preparing for Hajj. I'm sure many of you know family members, associates, relatives that are proceeding for Hajj within the next few days so that they may make it for the pilgrimage. May Allah make it easy for everyone, inshaAllah. Shaykh Wahba bin Al-Zuhayli, hafidhahullahu ta'ala, he's made a reference to one of the verses of Hajj. لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ. And in this verse, Allah speaks about Hajj is an occasion where there are manafi', there are so many benefits, there are so many positives. And then he gives a list. He says, there's so many physical benefits that are connected with Hajj. There are so many spiritual benefits that are connected with the pilgrimage. There are numerous economical, social, political benefits when we look at Hajj in its true sense. So I just wanted to give two reflections on the story of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him's preparation for Hajj. And what better narration can we refer to than the narration of Jabir radiallahu anhu. Jabir radiallahu anhu accompanied the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, on his Hajj. And he makes a mention in a very lengthy narration. He says that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was in Medina for 10 years. And in the 9 years that led up to his intention for Hajj, there was no pilgrimage, meaning that he didn't perform pilgrimage himself. In the 10th year, he had this intention. He made the intention to perform pilgrimage. And he made it known. He told the people, spread the word that I am intending to perform Hajj. So Jabir radiallahu anhu said that the news began to spread that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is going for Hajj. So the people assembled in Medina. And Jabir radiallahu anhu makes a mention, فَبَشَرٌ كَثِيرٌ. Medina became a place of so many people as the days of Hajj got closer. The people all wanted to accompany and join the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, in his pilgrimage. So Jabir radiallahu anhu says, finally, the last 5 to 7 days that remained of Dhul-Qa'dah, the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, the Prophet ﷺ, he made arrangements for his travel. And he selected the Qaswa camel. He had named some of his camels. So the Qaswa camel he had taken on this journey of Hajj. And they went to Dhul-Hulayfa to make the intention. He got onto his camel. Jabir radiallahu anhu says that I looked at every direction. Wherever I looked, madda aynay, I looked at every direction. And the furthest I could see, I just saw a sea of people. They had joined the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. In every direction I looked. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he made the intention for Hajj. And he said the talbiyah, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. That, oh Allah, I'm present. I'm answering your call. I'm submitting to what you have commanded me to do. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, proceeded. And the narration continues, but I would like to pause here and just reflect upon two particular lessons up to this point of the journey of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, to Hajj. Number one is the response to the call. The response to the call. We know that Hajj is an obligation, it's a fard. In fact, there are very severe connotations that are mentioned in the hadith, in authentic narrations, that a person who has the ability to perform Hajj, they have the resources to perform Hajj, they have the occasion, the time, the health, the wealth, they're able to make the arrangements, yet they don't go for Hajj, and the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, feared their outcome. He said, I fear their outcome. What will happen to them? Will they die with faith or will they die on another faith? So it's a mandatory pillar. وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. It's a duty upon those people who are able to perform Hajj for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the verse of Alu Imran points out. So responding to the call, we see that millions of people will be responding and they will assemble and they will gather. We see the footage on the satellite, we see the footage on the TVs, how people from all over the world, from different backgrounds, there are some from other parts of the world who save up their entire life just for the occasion of Hajj, just for the pilgrimage. So they're responding to the call. The lesson I want to drive home is that there are many calls that are made and we need to respond to the appropriate call. There's calls that are made for vice. There's calls that are made for good. But the believer only responds to the call of good. Just like these hujjaj, just like these pilgrims, they are responding to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they will continue to say labbaik. As soon as they put on their ihram, as soon as they make their intention, they will continue to call out labbaik. Oh Allah, I'm present, I've responded. I am here. In the same way, we are told to respond. And in our own personal lives, there are many calls. The adhan calls out every single day 5 times. Are we responding to this call? Are we responding to this call 5 times a day? There are calls and opportunities for us to volunteer. Are we responding to this call? Our parents, our teachers, our elders, many times they ask us to respond to a specific request, and it's full of goodness, it's full of mercy. Are we responding to this call? Right? We look at the situation in Syria, we look at the situation in Kenya, in Pakistan, the earthquakes. May Allah bless and bring prosperity and peace to all human beings across the globe. We condemn all kinds of violence wherever it is. Taking one life is like taking all humanity. We've heard this time and again. These are events that occur, but there's a call being made to you and I to give a helping hand, to provide relief to those who suffer. There are neighbors, there are community members within our own surroundings who have issues, they have problems, they need our support. We know about them, yet we don't respond. So one lesson we learn from Hajj is that we need to respond. The ultimate call is for the Hajj and the pilgrimage. However, every single day there are calls that are made, and we need to respond to the appropriate ones. And when we do so, we will definitely see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring prosperity. Every occasion that the Sahaba, the companions, the pious, they found for an opportunity of good, they felt it was a call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah, he mentions in the tafsir of the verse, أَلَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ سِرًّا وَعَلَانِيَةً. The translation of this verse, those people who spend in the night and in the day, they spend in secret and also in public. لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Allah promises there will be no fear for them and no grief, both in this world as well as in the hereafter. No stress. They constantly spend for good. So this verse, Ibn Abbas says, it was revealed regarding the likes of Ali ibn Abi Talib and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhumah, that these people, at one occasion, Ali radiallahu anhu had 4 dirhams. And he said, I'm going to spend one of them by the day, in the day. I'm going to spend one of them in the darkness of the night. I'm going to spend another one for a charitable cause in secret, and another one for a charitable cause in public. And that's when this verse was revealed. So the person, the individual, Ali ibn Abi Talib, and according to a report, Abu Bakr radiallahu an, only had these 4 dirhams, yet they took that as an opportunity to do good. They took that as an opportunity to respond to the call. And Allah responded to their action that He sent down the verse. So we learn from Hajj that we need to respond to the calls that are made constantly. We can't ignore these calls. They are all reminders. They are all reminders. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran speaks about, أَلَمْ يَأْنِنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُ. Has that time not come that the believers, their hearts start to tremble? So when we look at the background of this verse, it's opportunities of good that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to. So this is one lesson that we can reflect on when it comes to Hajj. And another thing is that we don't limit the good to ourselves. What did we see in this little part of the journey of the Prophet's sallallahu alayhi wasallam's Hajj, is that when he decided to do something good, he decided to go for Hajj, he made it known. He made it public. He got other people involved. He wanted to share with them in the blessings and the bounties. He didn't do it himself. So one lesson we learn from here is that when we have an intention to do good, then motivate others to also join. Motivate others to also be a part of that good. A believer is like the sun, it reflects rays. It has his own light and it also reflects that light. In the same way, we need to do good ourselves and share in the blessings and spread that good, spread that khair. Do the good, whatever we can. So we get other people involved, etc. Not too long ago, I was at a function, a wedding, and you know, many times the food comes very late and the event ends very late. So it was very late, and one of the brothers said, you know, let's make arrangements for Isha. Let's make arrangements to perform Isha. And many of the brothers were saying, you know what, Isha, you can pray until Fajr time, no problem. So he said, you know what? When we get home, we get so lazy that we just want to get to sleep. It's already so late. So if we make the arrangements for Isha right now, we perform the Isha, there's no worry, there's no concern. And possibly, if I am one of those people who is lazy, etc., I have now an environment, I have a group of people who will also be performing the Isha. And maybe there's other people like this as well. And everyone will be able to perform the Isha before they return home. So this is a sign of a believer that they don't limit the good to themselves. This person had concern for his prayer. And I'm sure if he went home, he probably would pray as well. But he had concern for everyone else as well. So he spread the good, he spread the khair. He did the good himself and he facilitated. He made the arrangements for everyone as well. So this is amongst those lessons that we can learn from Hajj. The Prophet ﷺ, he did the good himself, and he also motivated and encouraged others as well. One of my friends in South Africa, who's also a teacher of Hadith, etc., he wrote an article a couple of years back, and he titled it, "Going for Hajj Without Visas." Going for Hajj without visas. So what he was referring to, he's listed a number of narrations of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, with their source, as to what are those actions that we can do, we can perform, and we get the reward of Hajj. Hajj is still an obligation if we have not performed the Hajj. Yet there are many things the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, if you do these things, you'll get the reward as if you are performing Hajj, as if you are performing pilgrimage. And there's a huge list. Some of the things the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, talks about is performing Isha and performing Fajr in congregation, in the masjid. Reward of Hajj. It's a sacrifice, it's a struggle. Another thing the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, talks about in relation to this theme is that fulfilling your covenants, your agreements, your promises. A person is constantly worried about this, they will get the reward of Hajj when they fulfill that covenant and their agreements. So you can also Google this if you're interested. There's a huge list. Just remember the title, Hajj Without Visas. Hajj Without Visas. And this is, again, from one of my friends who has compiled this to show us that there are many opportunities of good. Again, sharing the good and being part of that mercy and that blessing that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't confine the blessings of Hajj to Hajj itself. In fact, in the very same narration that I gave reference to, Jabir radiallahu anhu points out at the conclusion of Hajj, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called a couple of people that were nearby. And he said, you know what, we've performed Hajj, but it doesn't end here. We've performed Hajj, but it doesn't end here. Now the real work starts. And that is to maintain the blessings and the inspiration that we are taking back from Hajj. So these are seasons, these are occasions where we are inspired and it raises the bar. However, at every moment there is a call that is being made to do good. At every moment there's an opportunity to share in blessings and share in khair. It's just a matter of taking that opportunity, valuing it, finding it, seeing it, and acting upon it. A sheikh was once asked, you know, what's the purpose of going around the Kaaba? Going around the Kaaba and making tawaf, what's the purpose? It seems very senseless. So he was talking about this very same theme, that we take the good and we continue to act upon it. And then he said, "Taaf al-jasadu bil-bayt." It's the body that is actually making the tawaf, the physical circling around the Kaaba, it's the body. But then he said, "Wataaf al-qalbu bi-rabbil bayt." That it's the heart that is making tawaf at all times around the Kaaba, meaning the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether we are on the holy lands or whether we are at home, the Rabb of the Kaaba, the Lord of the Kaaba, the Master, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is always there. And the call is always being made from Him that we continue to do good and we share and we spread that good. And by doing so, we will be amongst those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala announces paradise for, innal abrara lafi na'im, that the righteous will definitely go to paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the reality of all the lessons of Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to always respond to any call of good. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept and facilitate ease for all those who are proceeding for Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who succeed in this world as well as in the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.